always crazy to get out in the morning. So let's take a moment just to bow our hearts. Thank you, Lord, that when two or three are gathered, you say, "There, here you are in our midst," and we give thanks to you for that promise. In Jesus' name, amen. Our worship is an opportunity to really praise and honor the God we love. From the praise and worship and confession, we rightly align our lives and beliefs to his. So let us stand together and say the Nicene Creed, which we don't say all the time, but I think it's so powerful. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial to the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge baptism, forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Stay standing. Jesus also affirms in the Gospels that the foundation of all the commandments rest in love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So let us sing now of the great love of Jesus in the hymn, "Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus."
Around.
This week in our lesson, we just had a mess. Lots of stuff going on. The body of Christ was making bad decisions, and Paul needed to correct them. I couldn't help but think of a couple of verses that, as we talked about before, would help align our hearts to where the Lord would have us be. In 1 John 2:15, it says, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in them. For all that's in the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world." And then in Hebrews 12:1-2, he reminds us of the solution to our problem, fixing our eyes on him. And it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith." Let's sing together, "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus."
Strangely dim in the light.
like to take a moment for just silent confession, and then I will finish with a prayer. This prayer is by John Bailey. Holy God, to whose service I long ago dedicated my soul and life, I grieve and lament before thee that I am so prone to sin and so little inclined to obedience, so much attached to the pleasure of sense, so negligent of the things spiritual, so prompt to gratify my body, so slow to nourish my soul, so greedy for the present delight and so indifferent to lasting blessedness, so fond of idleness, so indisposed for labor, so soon at play and so late at prayer, so eager to get and so reluctant to give, so lofty in my profession and so low in my practice, so full of good intentions but so backward to fulfill them, so severe with my neighbors and indulgent with myself, so eager to find fault, so resentful of being found fault with, so little able for great task and so discontented with small ones, so weak in adversity and so swollen and self-satisfied in prosperity. O merciful heart of God, grant me yet again thy forgiveness. Hear my sorrowful tale, and in thy great mercy blot it out from the book of thy remembrance. Give me faith so to lay hold of thine own holiness and so to rejoice in the righteousness of Christ my Savior, that resting on his merits rather than my own, I may more and more become conformed to his likeness, my will becoming one with his in obedience to thine. All this I ask for his holy name's sake. Amen. And the assurance of pardon is, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I found a song this week that I know we haven't done here before. You may have heard it on the radio. It's called Greater Still by Brandon Lake, and it's just, the words are so powerful. So if you don't feel comfortable singing, then look at the words. But if you do feel comfortable singing, sing loud. And if there are any of the worship team that want to come up and help us, we would love that too.
Expected disappointment, love. join me as I offer a prayer for Mary, who will be teaching us this morning. Father, I just love that we are able to hear your truths through the voices of our dear sisters in Christ who speak to us on Thursday mornings. Today, we lift up Mary to you as she shares with us. She has prayed, studied, listened to discern your will for us as revealed in these passages of Scripture. I pray now that the Holy Spirit within her will shine forth brightly as we share these next few minutes together. In the sweet name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Might need a little swig. But it's a good thing that everything's already just been covered with this worship team and the songs and the everything in that. Sometimes I come here where we are, when my heart was so hard and crusty, everything and everybody's on my last nerve. I don't care much for other people. Does the Holy Spirit of God really live in me? It's too often not evident. But then we come in here and we sing, and we pray together. And my heart begins to soften up. It begins to melt just a little bit. It becomes soft, and I can hear again the voice of love speaking to me. Then I want to stay here forever, because that's just the best. Thank you, Joanne, Lynn, Leslie, Mary, for leading us into the throne room. Let's pray and ask God Almighty himself to speak to us and help us to understand his word and his heart for us today through this letter from Paul. Lover of our souls, why do you love us so much? We come here this morning, having looked at this lesson through our filters that we wear. We wonder what it means to be your children. How do we receive this section of your word properly? What kind of place is church supposed to be? Who is in, who is out, and what about Paul? What do we make of him? What do we make of those in authority around us right now? Dear God, help us sort through this and understand it as you would have us to understand it, as you have intended. Your word is sharper than a two-edged sword. We ask that you cut away what needs to be cut away. We ask that you restore what needs restoration. We ask that you create in us hearts that are loving, that are healed, that can receive your love and give it away to the next person we meet. We will trust you in this process. We will trust you with our surgery. We will allow you to work in our hearts, and we will ask for your wisdom as you work in others as you see fit. In Jesus' strong and gentle name we pray. Amen. God knows I hate to cry in public. It's a pride thing, I guess, but I know my friend Susan Orgain has tissues back there. Susan Orgain has a shirt just like this, and I hope she would wear it today. Is she here? Okay. Sorry. Have any of you ever been put out before? When I was in first grade, we had our desks, and they were in these, you know, four clumps of four. And I kept having to be moved from one foursome to another all over the classroom because I was a talker, and I would get everybody talking at the table. And so she moved me somewhere else. I guess I was being a problem. Anyway, my report cards were usually pretty good, but I would often get an N for needs to refrain from unnecessary talking. And this conduct grade, it was a modifiable problem, and I would get in trouble at home because of that. You know, if it was something else, maybe I'd have been all right, but that was something I could do something about. I thought so. Anyway, or have you ever had to put anybody out? When my two girls were growing up, they had a good friend who lived next door. And she was right in between their ages, and so the three of them would play together, and they would just have the best time. And the child's mother and I were excellent friends as well. We had similar values, and we had a little agreement. And if anybody was having a hard time being a good listener, if anybody was acting up, not responding to gentle redirections, company had to go home. It was a privilege to have company, to have little friends over. Also, it was a privilege to be company. So we were like sending our kids back and forth home. It worked out pretty good. It was known what the expectations were, and it was known what the consequences of being hard-hearted were. Being in the house of Mary or Karen came with some expectations. Sometimes I miss those days when things seemed simpler. Well, let's get out this letter from Paul to the church at Corinth that we've been looking at these past few weeks. To review who Paul is, well, he was possibly the most Jewishest guy of the Jewish people that there ever was. Formerly known as Saul of Tarsus, he was super smart and strong and zealous for God. He had been on his way to Damascus, where he'd planned to straighten out, take to the rock concert those that had thought Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah. However, on the road, he ran directly into Jesus, the Messiah himself. Paul, his Greek name, had radical soul surgery on the road near Damascus. In a moment, the Holy Spirit gave Paul a new heart. His friends scraped him off the road, took him to the level one trauma center in Damascus, where Paul was found to be blind and unable to eat or drink anything for 3 days. His friends didn't really know what to make of this. It was just a scary time for them. He was admitted for observation, and God called in the hospital chaplain to come talk to Paul. Ananias, the chaplain, was a bit reluctant because he had heard of this guy Saul and how he had persecuted the Christians hither and yon. But Ananias obeyed God and went and prayed for this former public enemy number one from the young church's perspective. Ananias prayed for brother Saul to be able to see again and to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, Dr. Luke was the on-call trauma surgeon at Damascus General, and he tells us, as recorded in his progress notes, also known as Acts chapter 9, that Paul immediately began his ministry of telling everybody that would listen about Jesus, because God had said that Paul is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. This is the hard part, poor Paul. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Okay. Is that how y'all's Bible reads? This is the unauthorized girlfriend version. This is the introduction to Paul, drawn from Acts. You ladies, be careful. Read your own Bibles yourself. Ask God to help you understand it, because everybody has their own ideas and their own gospels, but we here at Women's Bible Study are interested in trying to discern what God himself is saying to us. Okay, after Paul's traumatic conversion experience and recovery period, he went around preaching in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. That's Acts chapter 19 and forward. He went on 3 missionary journeys through the Greco-Roman world. He was preaching and shaking up all the peoples of whatever stripe, Jews, Gentiles, Greeks, Greekish Jews, Jewish Greeks, everybody, Romans. This got Paul into a fair amount of trouble. People were all the time running him out of town, trying to kill him, but God worked mightily through his servant Paul. Paul was doing the job that God had given him, and Paul was answerable to God for his actions, and he was empowered and authorized by God to do his job. Remember back last semester when we were studying Mark, the parable of the sower, and in chapter 4, you know, Jesus is throwing seed generously, willy-nilly everywhere, you know, not worried about each one, but just throwing the word of God out. So this is what Paul is now doing. He's throwing out kingdom seeds all over the Greco-Roman world. He went from being a zealous persecutor of his church and of Jesus to a zealous evangelist to the world. Did his relationship with Jesus completely change him from the inside out? Completely? On a second missionary journey, Paul had planted the church in Corinth. He stayed there for 1.5 years, pouring his heart and life into these new baby Christians. The members of the church in Corinth did not have a Jewish background. What kind of background did they have? Well, Corinth had a reputation for commercial prosperity, but it was also known for evil living. Oh, yeah, yeah. It's a real place, y'all. That's in Tennessee, but Corinth is, okay, just saying, Corinth is in our hearts. Okay, yeah. Okay, commercial prosperity, but also known for evil living. The word Corinthia zestai, however you say it, meant to live like a Corinthian, and it had become part of the Greek language, and it meant to live with drunken and immoral debauchery. The very name Corinth was synonymous with debauchery, and there was one source of evil in the city which was known all over the civilized world. Above the isthmus towered the hill of the Acropolis, and on the Acropolis stood the great temple of Aphrodite, the goddess of love. To that temple there were attached 1,000 priestesses who were sacred prostitutes. In the evenings they descended from the Acropolis and plied their trade upon the streets of Corinth until it became a Greek proverb, "It is not every man who can afford a journey to Corinth." In addition to these cruder sins, there flourished far more recondite vices. I had to Google, what is recondite? A secret, hidden, concealed, private, which had come in with the traders and sailors from the ends of the earth until Corinth became not only a synonym for wealth and luxury, but also for drunkenness and debauchery, and also for filth. The Corinthian believers didn't have a long cultural history of worshiping the one and only God that we learn about in our Old Testament. They had no frame of reference from which to spring into worshiping this God-man Jesus. Living a holy life was a completely foreign concept to them, so Paul had taught them from scratch. He planted the seeds and others came to water and build up this church. After Paul left to start some other churches, some members in the church began to have some doubts and confusion about what they'd been taught. Did you have your theology just perfect after a year and a half following Jesus? Me neither. So, but we're here and we're learning and growing together. Amen? Okay. Think about these Corinthian brothers and sisters as being young in the faith or teenage Christians. They were trying to sort out all the things that they had learned. Some of it was kind of hard and convicting. Surely there was a temptation to soften things up a little bit, make it a little easier. Grace, remember? Yay. I think there's more of that in lessons to come. There might have been a little bit of an echo back to that voice heard in the Garden of Eden, the Genesis chapter 3, where the serpent says to Eve, "Did God really say? Did Paul really say?" Well, what is being a Christian anyway? What is born again? What does it mean to worship God with all my heart, my soul, my mind, and my strength? I think we talked about that in Deuteronomy just a minute ago. Why all this? We were created by God to be in relationship with Him. I got to show you something now. Hang on. Okay. Yeah, we were created to be God, to be in relationship with God. We need to be nourished and treated as the precious people, the precious creations of God that we are. Throughout our lives, God is calling us into relationship with Himself. He is our primary need meter. He uses people, imperfect as we are, to care for us as we grow. Think about being a baby inside your mom. You're growing in there, and you're getting everything you need from your mom by way of your umbilical cord. All the good nutrients. Mom eats the good groceries. You get the good groceries. It goes in there, and somehow the wastes go back out. We don't know. It all works so marvelously, all safe and snug in there. Then we're born, and we're still in a helpless state. Mom and Dad meet all our needs. We grow up in our families. We learn many things. God gives parents the responsibility to raise up these little people, these little precious little ones that He's created. In our Bible, we hear all about this God who loves us. God has made a way for us to connect with Him through His Son, Jesus. This God who loves us more than we can fathom. And inside our hearts or our spirits, there is this God-shaped hole that only He can fill. And we are a needy bunch. As humans on this planet, we all have needs. Acceptance, affirmation, appreciation, belonging, security, comfort, love, identity, safety, and respect. Everybody has needs. And until we find our rest and security and belonging and safety and identity in our relationship with God, it is like we are running around trying to connect our umbilical cords to everything. You know, it's like, that's what we do. This is what the people of Corinth were doing. This is what everybody does before they are adopted into the family of God and begin to be transformed over time, sometimes quickly and other times slowly, into being true sons and daughters of the Most High God. Apart from God or God's plan, where do we go to get our needs met? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Oh, wait, what decade am I from? We try to get our needs met through social media, getting likes and followers, our jobs, our families, sports, community service, acquiring things, getting rich, getting skinny, getting fat, knowing the right people, having the right friends, attending the right church, being smart, being good looking, and trying to be good enough. And when we fail at all these, and all these fail to satisfy us, we feel empty. And that's no good. So we numb our pain with more of all that, or with substances, or addictions, or TV, or judging others, or we trade our relationships in for new ones, and then we try to attach our umbilical cords to them. Somehow, if we can just perform right, things should work out, we think. But our efforts, are they ever enough? Can we save ourselves through our actions? Do we grow tired and despairing for trying? Hear these words from the Lord Jesus from Matthew chapter 11. Come, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the only place where Jesus describes himself. Corinth was just a place full of a bunch of people trying to get their basic needs met, doing the best they could. They were carrying on with life the way they had been taught in their families and in their culture. They were connected to and in bondage to their counterfeit gods. Are we much different? Back to this letter to the believers in Corinth. Had Paul really said that as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, they were to look, act, and be different from what they had been before? What was this new way of living they were being called to? What kind of life were those adopted into the family of God supposed to lead? There were disagreements among them, so they sent Papa Paul a letter outlining their questions and concerns. Paul answered their concerns, gave them some wisdom as a father would his beloved children. Paul took very seriously his role, calling himself their father and the Corinthian believers, my dear children. He called them to obedience to what they were taught. He caused them to imitate him as he imitates Christ. He was modeling for them what it looks like to connect their umbilical cord to God. Yeah. I'm just stuck on these visuals, y'all. You got to bear with me. You know, it's my need meter. And short of this, I'm sticking this on everybody and everything, trying to figure out who I am and get what I need. So if I'm hooked up to love himself, who meets all my needs according to his riches and glory, that fills me up. And I have something to give to somebody else. Okay? Otherwise, I'm trying to, got a stranglehold over my idols trying to get from them. It just doesn't work. Where was I? Okay. Yeah, he was modeling what it looks like to connect their umbilical cords to God. He taught them how to orient themselves to God and keep doing so on the journey back to wholeness, back to completeness, back to the Garden of Eden. This transformation is directed by and empowered by the Holy Spirit. And we aren't going to be allowed to drag that dang lying snake back in there with us. Hear the word of the Holy Spirit through another of Paul's letters. It's from Philippians. And my God will meet all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And then let's look at the words of Jesus as recorded in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. But seek ye first, sisters, God's kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things we think we need, and we do need, all these things will be given to you as well. What are some practical ways that we can turn our face to this Most High God that loves us so much? We're going to have to turn our faces away from some other things. We're going to have to separate ourselves, give ourselves some space from people who are holding on very tightly to counterfeit affections. idolatry, or old ways of thinking are so familiar and easily slipped back into. Our hearts are deceitful and wicked and so prone to drift back into ungodliness that we must take measures not to do this. We have to attach our umbilical cords daily, moment by moment, to the Holy Spirit for nourishment, cleansing, renewal, empowerment, and an infusion of love that casts out all fear and brings peace and satisfaction. We do this in our private worship, at our home, and in prayer. We connect to God with our families at home, with our sisters here at Women's Bible Study, and in corporate worship at church. And by being connected to God and filled and refilled with His Spirit, guided by truth, we have something worthwhile to share with others and with our spouses and our kids and our neighbors out of the overflow of that relationship we have with our need meter, capital M, need meter. Paul had told them previously not to associate with sexually immoral people, not at all meaning the regular people they run into outside the church in Corinth, but in this letter he more specifically tells them, you must not associate with anyone who claims to be a believer, but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater, a slanderer, a drunkard, or a swindler. Don't even eat with such people. That was from chapter 5, verse 11. Paul was especially distressed to hear about the guy who was having an ongoing sexual relationship with his father's wife. This behavior, incest, was shocking to people who were not easily shocked by ungodly behavior, unclean need meeting. This section of scripture we're talking about today reveals three concerns. Number one, what is the man doing? Number two, what is the church not doing? And number three, on what basis is Paul exercising authority? We don't have preserved the minutes from the session meeting in Corinth where the members' behavior was discussed and the steps that were taken to be bringing him lovingly back to correction were recorded. We don't have the progress notes from the measures taken to preserve this valuable man within the body of Corinth. You know, think about that metaphor of the body of Christ. Okay, this man, think about him as being a foot, perhaps. A foot that's gone bad. He's connected to the body. He is valuable and dear. But just like when somebody has bad diabetes and horrible circulation, they need an amputation. It's not something you rush into. You do your best with medicine. Lesser surgical procedures. Maybe you get a little bypass going to the leg and you hope the foot's going to pink back up. You do things to try to bring restoration before having to do something very hard. But if the foot doesn't get better, it can cause illness and infection that will kill the whole person. The foot has to come off to save the whole person's life. For a year and a half, Paul had taught the believers of Corinth what living in a relationship with their loving Heavenly Father looks like. They'd probably done a 13-week Bible study on Leviticus, chapter 18, outlining who and what one does not have sexual relationships with. And they probably did a January term on the concepts found in Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 to 17, about how to work through conflicts with fellow believers. So when Paul heard again about this guy sleeping with his stepmom, he probably said, "What the hamburger?" His exclamation was not recorded. But in his letter, Paul did say four times that they were to put this guy out of the fellowship. This was a step to both heal the body of believers from continued strife and distraction, and can we say contamination? Sin is contagious. Nope. But alas, but also, maybe by finally putting the guy out, that might wake him up enough to where he could be in enough pain to seek God for healing from his intractable idolatry. Intractable means it's really hard to get. It's hard. When we talk about intractable illnesses, they're hard. His inability or unwillingness, don't know which it was, it's probably a combination, in his inability or unwillingness to extricate himself from this counterfeit affection. And Paul had told them specifically, the church of Corinth, how they were supposed to do it. They were supposed to do it in church. The whole community must carry out the action because the leaven has affected them as a community. And as a community of the Spirit, they must act in accordance with the Spirit's direction that has now been given through Paul. Y'all, one time in the past year, I came home and right beside my little sidewalk going in the house, laying beside the, you know, just here's a bush, there was a hammer. It's like, whose hammer is this? What is it? Why is there a hammer at my You know, where somebody go break in and then they stop and left their hammer. I don't know. So, but, you know, when I read this, I hear this hammer, bam, you know, or a gavel almost like, what is going on? But let's revisit the Paul as parent theme for a minute. You ladies love, love, love your children, don't you? You would do anything to protect them. You teach them the ways that they should go. You do your best. And if somebody messes with your child, does that upset you? Or if your child is in danger, do you sit idly by? It's a wonder my daughter Grace doesn't have some kind of shoulder problems. One time, a van was about to back over her in the parking lot at the grocery store. We were walking out to the car, and I had hold of her hand, and I saw that, you know, we were walking along, and that van starts backing up, and I said, whoop! She went flying, and she didn't get hit by the car. Anyway, so I jerked her up and out of the path rather decisively. And then when she was 7 or 8, we were taking a walk around the block, and we came to this yard that didn't have any fence, and this gigantic dog, a good-sized dog, almost like a Doberman, started running towards us kind of fast. And it's like, mm-mm. I grabbed her and I slung around behind me, and I gave that dog a mama bear's gonna kill you look, and I said, get back, and I said it really mean and much louder than that, and that dog said, ran back the other way. But that was another time Grace got slung around. So, poor Grace. And then one other time, this is all, I just got all kind of stories today. We were pulling away from a Panera bread place in South Carolina. She was older then, about 14 years old. We had gone on this big trip, and we'd long ago covered how to ride in the car. You know, you ride in the car, you put your seatbelt on. Well, a bug, a South Carolina bug, don't you know, got into the back seat, and suddenly there's all this screaming going on, and somebody opened the car door. I stopped our moving car, got out, removed the bug, slammed that door shut, and I said in a clear, loud, perceived as hateful voice, and keep the bankety bank door shut. Okay, I'm getting dramatic, sorry. Nobody died that day, but it did hurt her feelings that I used that kind of tone of voice. It might be tempting to read this passage of Scripture, to read this whole letter, and think that Paul is mean or harsh or intolerant or whatever. But with the help of the Holy Spirit, see if you can read it more as a father who dearly loves his children and he's trying to help them navigate life in the kingdom of God. He has taught the Corinthian believers who they are as precious, blood-bought, washed, adopted, fully gifted, beloved children of the Most High God. He didn't want to have his children getting mixed back up again with the sexually immoral or the greedy or the idolaters or the slanderers or drunkards or swindlers. They had just been freed from that bondage. They had been forgiven and brought into a right relationship with God. He didn't want them getting bound up again with the powers of darkness. We're about done here, y'all. Whew. You might be thinking, well, thank God I'm not sleeping with my stepdad. I'm good. Whoosh. This reminds me of the parable in Luke chapter 18 that Jesus tells of the two girls going to women's Bible study on Thursday morning. One lady was feeling pretty good about her personal holiness. She'd completed her lesson, baked cookies for the hungry, even prayed for her neighbor's ailing cat. During the time of confession, she thanked God that she wasn't like some of her fellow sisters or the people of Corinth or other places who were sexually immoral, greedy, idolatrous, gossipy, alcoholics, drug addicts, or cheats. But the other lady, she couldn't speak. She didn't want to make eye contact with anybody. She just felt defeated and trapped, thinking things were hopeless and she could never change. Her problems were longstanding. She could not fix them. She had tried. Though she could not speak, she cried out to God, saying, have mercy on me, a sinner. Oops, slipped into the unauthorized girlfriend, paraphrase again. It's good to be thankful for the problems that we don't have, but let's pause a second and think about what sexual immorality means. It comes from the Greek word porneia. In Hellenistic Judaism, porneia was never a good thing, and its meaning covered all extramarital sexual sins and aberrations, including homosexuality. This word was used in the New Testament to refer to the blight on Greco-Roman culture, which was almost universally accepted, tolerated, supported, encouraged, and celebrated. That is why porneia appears so often as the first item in the New Testament vice list, not because Christians were sexually hung up, nor because this was considered the primary sin or the scarlet letter, as it were. It was the result of its prevalence in the culture and the difficulty the church experienced with its Gentile converts breaking with their former ways, which they did not consider immoral. Are we sexually immoral? Did we sleep with our husbands before we were married? Are we sleeping with people or pretending like we're married and we're not? With whom are we one? Sex is created by God to be enjoyed in the covenantal marriage between a man and a woman. The two become one. This is God's math. He doesn't want us becoming one every which way we make up. Sexual sin causes our souls to fracture to pieces, and we cannot bond properly with our spouse. Sexual sin puts our heart, our soul, through a meat grinder eventually. It hurts us, it destroys families, and this is why God forbids it. God gives us his law, and it is meant to be diagnostic, not therapeutic. If you use a thermometer, it tells you you're sick, but it doesn't make you better. Law reveals illness. Scanners in the airport, you know, when you go to get on the plane, they scan for contraband. The Holy Spirit scans us and brings us to conviction. If we ignore him, we continue in our sickness, our sin, and it grows and reproduces and eventually brings death. In love, a brother or sister is going to bring us correction, do a pat down, like a good TSA person. We need our brothers and sisters in Christ to call us to holiness, call us on our BS. I'm full of it sometimes, y'all. Our hearts are desperately wicked and we don't even know it. We need accountability and correction in the body of Christ. It is loving. We don't call down other people's kids, but our own, yes, we do. And I'm not saying this is easy, but it's important and vitally necessary in this world we live in. It is damaging to misdiagnose sin as not sin. It is not loving. It's really about our hearts, beloved. We have been saved. We are not free to sin, but we are free to not sin. But that's just the way I am. No, that is the way you were. You are a new creature now. Walk in it. And if you need a walker, or if you need some people to walk alongside you and pick you up when you fall, then you're just like the rest of us. Ask for help. I've got about just 10 more rants, and then we're done. So think about a train. The tracks have two rails, justice and mercy. They are tethered together so that you don't veer off into some kind of train wreck one way or the other. All justice, and you are mean and hurtful, and everybody dies. All mercy, and you've got lawless chaos and fear and heartbreak, and again, everybody dies. We need both justice and mercy to stay on track and grow us into the godliness we are called to, into growing into our love relationship with our Creator. He is not going to change. Then there's this other tracks. On the way to Tennessee about a month ago, I saw that Corinth sign. I thought, I like that. You know, I'm just going to teach this. And I saw these train tracks. And I want you to see how those two sets of train tracks, they both have justice and mercy and justice and mercy. And we're on one side of those, whatever. And the other people, they're on the other side. But both those train tracks are going to the cross right there. They're taking us to Jesus. And so my little sin pattern might look different from the people's sin pattern on the other track. And we think of each other as them and us. But you know what? We're all broken, and we're all going to the cross. And we've all got those justice and mercy rails that we're bumping up against one way or the other. We're getting there. And somebody pointed this out to me. What's that third track over there? I don't know what that third track is. It might be going somewhere different. And I'm not saying all roads lead to Jesus, but we're going to the cross, and we're asking God to mess with us and bring us healing. And anyhow, lost my place. Oh, wow. We're going right into some more deep weeds if we're not already there. Here we go. If we are at odds with the call to purify our hearts, if we are involved in, let's say, immorality, one of two things will happen. We will either alter our lifestyle and repentance and realign ourselves with God, or we will continue our immoral lifestyle unrepentant and then have to redefine God in a way that accommodates our immoral posture. This is from Alistair Begg, a sermon I heard, and it's like, oh, that's interesting. I listen to things when I'm in the kitchen. I heard that. And then it's like, oh, I should probably write some of that down. And then I'll just, whatever. But then somehow it got downloaded 13 times onto my phone. So every time I go, well, let me listen to something, the same thing would come up. It's like, all right then. Okay, let me write. I must have needed to hear that a few times. I often need to hear correction a few times. What about y'all? We are baptized into Jesus. Are we baptized into him or the world? By baptizing, we're kind of like soaking and pickling into Jesus. If we're doing that, then I'm changed. But if I'm baptized or pickled into the world, I'm tolerant or habituated to all manner of worldly thinking, believing, and behaving. If I'm baptized into the name of Jesus, I belong to him. Oh, got to get my next prop out. Okay. So if I'm baptized into Jesus, I belong to him. Me and all my problems. You're going to have a lot of work cut out for you, Jesus. Just saying. All my unholy desires. All my crazy thinking. My strong habits of judging others and ignoring my own poo, my own sin. But here I am. The Holy Spirit is in my hula hoop with me 24/7 to guide and direct and to love and to comfort me and to cleanse me and fill me with his love. Over the past 12 or 13 years, while battling my own fallen nature, I've had the privilege of seeing into the lives of people who struggle with substance abuse. I've worked as a counselor, and I've done a bunch of assessments, lots of assessments. I've worked, I'm sitting in the room talking with somebody, and they'll tell me about whatever substance they're struggling with. They'll tell me about their use of that. But then, you know, comprehensively, I said, well, what about this and what about that? Different kind of substances, and I've been shocked how they'll laugh and they'll judge people differently that use other substances. Like, yes, cocaine is ruining my life, but I would never use dot, 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 dot. Okay. And I've had similar things when doing assessments, mental health assessments, asking about mental health symptoms. Yes, I struggle with thoughts of suicide daily, but no, I don't hear voices. I'm not crazy. Okay. You know, we tend to think about certain sins as being wholly different in a whole different category. Yeah, I might do or have done this, that, and the other, but I would never fill in the blank, you know. Let's look at this letter to the Corinthians as a diagnostic tool to see how far we might be from Jesus on these issues. And let's ask him to bring us healing and cleansing from our sins. Let's not judge others who suffer similarly or differently than we do. Here's my closing rant, prayer, exhortation. You ready? If you're smart, don't judge the dumb people. If you're dumb, don't judge the smart people. If you're rich, don't judge the poor people. If you're poor, don't judge the rich people. If you're ugly, don't judge the pretty people. If you're pretty, don't judge the ugly people. If you're strong, don't judge the weak. If you're weak, don't judge the strong. If you struggle with sexual sin, don't judge those who don't. If you don't struggle with sexual sin, don't judge those that do. Let's just kind of close our eyes and pray right now. We're done here. Dear God, help us. God, if you're real, we want to know you more and more. Lord, I confess my tendency to weasel to the side and avoid conflict by not being straightforward. Sometimes my confessions are wimpy because I can lie and I don't want to admit it. I want to steal snacks. I want to talk about others in an effort to lift myself up. Help me get back in my hula hoop. I'll be busy enough repenting for my own stuff. We're going to need to hang out nearer the cross and keep coming back to the cross. We've got to keep moving back into the light so we can see better what is broken and ask God to please fix it. We want to be in your club, Jesus, in your family, full of broken, full of the broken who fall short every day, who see things upside down, who can't fix themselves or ourselves. We want to be loving and kind. We want to live as Christians, but it's going to be hard, especially if we need to put somebody out. Just ask John the Baptist, ask Paul, ask the disciples, ask missionaries, ask martyrs across space and time. Ask anyone who has been labeled and then disregarded. Help us, Lord, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much, Mary. We can certainly relate from your honest approach to these hard things. We're going to invite you to join us in singing a song of response to the truths that we have experienced this morning. I invite you to listen for the promise to serve, the petition for guidance, and the strength to deny sin of the world until the day of eternal rest. Let this be our prayer. You want to stand?
Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I have promised an older hymn, but a great one.
Let us go forth with the determination to live boldly for Christ in the security and freedom proclaimed by Paul in 1 Corinthians 6:11. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Christy is still getting over COVID, and she's in a mask now, so she will be hopefully back with us next week. But I wanted to say thank you for Mary and for the worship team for all that you've done to serve us and to help us focus on Jesus this morning. So today is Have Lunch With Your Small Group Day. So from 11:30 to 12:30, we'll have lunch together. There's plenty to share. So if you didn't bring anything, stay and just enjoy being with your group. Anyway, all right. So Christy usually gives us something to talk about with our neighbor. So what's going on this week in my household is that I have a dear, dear friend, and God gifted me this friend almost 30 years ago. So we were both moving to Winston-Salem at exactly the same time, and we were each had our own realtors, and we were looking for a house, and over that four-day period, we kept showing up at the same house at the same time. And one of us would have to wait for the other one to get finished. So by the fourth day, we're out in Davie County, and I'm in the clubhouse of this new neighborhood that's going up, and I've got my packet, and I'm leaving, and in comes my friend. And I think it's great. So I'm waving at her, hi, and she's just really didn't want to see me because she thought we would end up in a war over the same house. So, you know, we each bought houses that the other one didn't look at. And a few weeks later, we're at K&W with our families getting dinner, and we spotted each other. And so God gifted me Paula. She's been a dear, dear friend for many years. I also lead a Bible study, a women's Bible study in the evening. Anybody's welcome anytime, but a lot of these ladies work during the day and they can't be here in the morning. They're so dear to me. And Paula comes on Thursday night. So she lost her mother this week. Her mom passed away on Monday. And so she's Greek. And so our Bible study, our evening Bible study, is serving at the visitation tonight. And what an honor it is to be able to be with her and to serve the family during a time that's really hard for them. So here's my question for you. Has God ever gifted you a friendship that was in the most unlikely place? And just talk with each other about that. It's good to see you each. I hope you stay for lunch. Have a good weekend.